So real quickly, I wanted to introduce our speaker for tonight, because most of you probably do not know him. His name is Philip Baus. He's the youth minister at Peachtree City Church of Christ in Georgia, in Peachtree City, Georgia, also known as the church that is stealing Stan Butt to some of you. I know he's, okay, he's looking at me now. But anyway, I'm really excited about him. Me and Philip have been friends for a really long time. We roomed together in college. I have a lot of respect for him, although that was questioning at times in college. But I'm really excited to listen to him speak. I know that he does great things at Peachtree City, and he'll do great for us tonight.
Well, good evening. How do you, I don't even know. I could tell you things about Malvin. Y'all like Malvin? Anybody not like Malvin? Raise your hand. Anybody not like Malvin? I don't really like Malvin. I'm just kidding. Best friends. Highland kids don't like Malvin. That makes sense. Well, just want to start out with telling you that Malvin and I used to do what you're doing right now. Now, it was a lot smaller. I'm we grew up on the south side of Atlanta. The church is not as big, and we still do area-wise. We did area-wise back then. That's actually how Malvin and I met one another. Is it area-wide devotionals? He went to Fairview. I went to McDonough, and we became very, very good friends. We went to camp together multiple times. We were, we stayed in the same cabin, and we would always look forward to being able to spend time with one another, our families, our friends. And my uncle was one of the ministers at the church that I grew up at, and he had this saying that I thought was just something that preachers said. And I don't know. I didn't know if it was true, or I don't even really know what it meant. But he would always tell us to make your best friends your church friends. And I thought, well, okay, that's fine. That's something that I guess I could think about doing. And I did that. I did that with Malvin. And I had lots of friends in high school. I don't talk to any of them. Like, the day I graduated high school, I don't think I spoke to anybody that I actually went to high school with. But Malvin and I have been best friends all since high school. We've done lots of things. We've done lots of things together. We have laughed together. We've cried together. We've laughed together. We've yelled at one another. We've laughed together. We were there beside one another when both of us got married. We were co-commissioners in our fantasy football league because both of us cheat. And so that's not a joke. That is incredibly factual, probably the most factual thing I'll say tonight. That was a joke, a bad joke. But anyway, Now that it's gotten weird for everybody, I just want to say thank you. I'm really excited to be here. This is different for me because normally area-wides is a much, much smaller group, and typically Peachtree City brings about 75% of the kids to the function, and it's just not something that's really big on our calendar. And so to come up and see that this is a big deal to y'all, it's something that's pretty exciting, and we're super excited about Mr. Stan coming and being able to hang out with us down in Atlanta. I love Atlanta. I love my city. I know some of you have been giving Malvin a hard time about the Super Bowl last week. That's not cool, but we know that the spring training is about to start and that the Braves are about to be back in business. And so all last week has been forgiven, and we're ready for some Braves baseball. So tonight, I want to tell a story. It's a story you probably heard before. That's how I learn. I don't know how you learn. Maybe you're a visual learner. Maybe you're somebody that has to be able to actually kind of feel something and see how it works. I learn through stories, and so that's how I try to teach. It's a story that you've heard, but I read an article just a few weeks ago that said we live in a post-Christian era, and what that means is you can't walk into a place and say, well, you know the story of Jonah, because a lot of people don't. A lot of people don't know these basic traditional accounts of the history, especially in the Old Testament. And so I want to share that with you tonight, and I hope that you'll find something in it that's meaningful to you, and that you'll leave here changed, more looking more like your Savior, Jesus Christ. But before we do that, let's pray together. God in heaven, we're thankful for today. We're thankful for the opportunity we have as your people and as your children to gather together. And it's a crazy world that we live in. It's stressful. It's hard. It's not easy. We're thankful that we have one another, and I ask that you be with each of these teenagers that are here. Help them to make their best friends, their church friends, because I know from personal account that it will bless your life. And God, I ask that tonight as we dig into a piece of history from your word, your servant Jonah. Help us to find something within that account that applies to us, that'll change us, and that will help us as we try to live every day to look like your son Jesus. And it's in his most precious name that we pray. Amen. So why do I want to talk about Jonah? I believe that we're just like Jonah. I think that anybody that's familiar, we're all familiar with the story, I would imagine. We're gonna talk about it. We're gonna talk about it again. If you want to get your Bibles out, we're gonna be in. We're gonna read some of it. I'm gonna tell some of it. But I believe, and this is kind of the premise of everything I'm gonna say tonight. So if you don't get this point, then the rest of it's not gonna make any sense. I believe we're just like Jonah. I believe that if we look at our lives, if we look at the way that we live, and we look at the lives that we're expected to live, that it looks a lot like what was on Jonah's plate when Jonah walked this earth. So if you're going to pull out your Bibles, we're going to get in Jonah chapter 1. Like I said, I'm going to read a little bit, I'm going to tell a little bit, and we're going to try to get through the first two chapters. I'm not going to read everything word for word, but I think it's important. And so I hope you got your Bibles, because I want to study with you this evening. Jonah chapter 1 and verse 1 says, "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, 'Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come before me.'" Look at this next word. "But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord." Anybody identify with that? God says, "I've got something that I really want you to do," and I'm not suggesting that he's come to you and given you a specific message, but we all have been called by God to do something. How many of us have ever done exactly what God told us not to do? God says, I want you to go to Nineveh. I have a job. I have a goal. I want you to call out against these people. And what does Jonah do? If you look at it on a map, he could not have gone a more opposite direction. He went to Joppa. He got on a boat to go to Tarshish. Why? Why did he do that? Because he didn't want to go. Sometimes some people have suggested that Jonah wanted to get away from God. I think Jonah was a prophet. I think Jonah understood that he couldn't get away from God. And we know that the psalmist, he said this in Psalm 139, verses 7 and 8. "Where shall I go from your spirit, or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there." I think that Jonah understood he couldn't get away from God. Okay? But I think just like Jonah, we're all running. I think we're all trying to get away from something. Maybe we're trying to get towards something. Maybe Jonah was trying to get away from God. I think that Jonah was probably trying to get away from Nineveh. And you think, well, why would he try to get away from Nineveh? Have you ever wanted to get away from what it is that God had called you to do? Think about it. Have you ever wanted to get away from what it was that God has called you to do? Maybe at your school, the opportunity that you have to share with your friends, the opportunity that you have maybe at home to be a leader to a younger brother or sister. Have you ever completely gone in the opposite direction and ran away from what it was that God had called you to do? Now, in our minds, this direct command from God to Jonah seems pretty simple, but yet Jonah was so disinterested in doing, whether he was trying to get away from God or whether he was trying to get away from what God was calling him to do. The point was, he wasn't doing what God wanted him to do, right? He was doing the exact opposite, for that matter. And so the question I want to ask just for just a second is this. Where do you go when you want to get away from God? Where do you go when you want to get away from what it is that God has called you to do? Where do you go when you want to get away from the place or maybe the thing that you know that God has planned for you? Maybe it's a relationship that you know that you're the only person that will be able to share Christ with. And again, we could go through numerous different opportunities. It may be something that you know you need to own up to. Where do you go when you want to get away from God? Where is your Tarshish? For some of us, it's probably an app on our phone that our parents don't know that we have. And it's something that we're ashamed of, and if our youth minister know, we'd be embarrassed, but it's a place that we go late at night when we don't have the restrictions that others have, and we ease a pain that we may have. Or maybe for some of us, it's a friend whose parents go to bed way too early, and they leave their liquor cabinet unlocked. We all know those places that we go. And this isn't just for teenagers, this is for adults. Adults, unfortunately, not only do they sometimes want to get away from God, they have way more opportunity and ability to get to Tarshish, right? They have way more boats in their life that are heading away from God, and they have the opportunity to get on those boats. And so tonight, I want to start out by trying to draw a similarity in your life to Jonah's life. All of us are running to something. I hope that you're running to God. I hope that you're running towards what he's called you to do. But I know that if you're like me, and I've been where you are before, and I don't say that like because that's what youth ministers say. I'm telling you, I've been there. It's real easy to get on a boat and to run from God. It's real easy to put Tarshish in the GPS and say, this is where I want to go because it feels safe and it feels easier. And it feels like it's the path of least resistance, but I want to encourage you, listen to the story of Jonah, because it didn't work out too well for him. Let's keep reading in the story. We know he gets on the boat. He heads to Tarshish. He's on the boat. Verse 4, but the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and there was a mighty tempest. Let that be a lesson to you, right? When you try to get away from God, when you try to do exactly what God has told you not to do, or when you don't do what God has told you to do, there will be a mighty tempest on the sea. So that ship was threatened to break up. And so everybody kind of worries. I used to live on the Gulf. I used to live in Pensacola. And so I would go out fishing in my kayak. I've been about a mile and a half out when nasty weather shows up. It's not any fun. It's pretty scary. And you're paddling as quick as you can trying to get back. And that's quite a bit different. I mean, that's just as the storm showing up. I imagine if God is intentionally trying to make a point, he does a pretty good job of it. And so we know that the mariners or the people that are on this boat, they start to get upset. They start to worry. They start throwing things overboard. They start looking for what's the cause of this. They start crying out to their gods. And finally, they stumble upon Jonah, who is fast asleep in the bottom of the boat. Now this, I mean, you think about this, if you're one of the people who are on the boat, you're one of the mariners who is in absolute crisis mode, who's throwing stuff overboard, who's crying out to the God, and you find somebody who's asleep, that would kind of trouble you. So they come to Jonah, and they wake him up, and they say, come let us cast lots. What are you doing? Come let us cast lots. Verse 7 in Jonah chapter 1, that we may know whose account this evil has come upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Duh, right? Jonah was the one that was trying to get away from God. Jonah was the one who was trying to get away from what God was calling him to do. And so God's trying to kind of prove this point to him. He's trying to send him a message. And of course, the lot's going to fall on Jonah. And these mariners, these people who were on the boat with him, they knew that he was trying to run away from God. And so they say Jonah, what do we do? All right, what are we supposed to do? Verse 9, and he said to them, I am a Hebrew. I fear the Lord God of heaven who made the sea and the dry land. Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, what is it that you have done? For the men knew that it was that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. Look at verse 12. And he said to them, pick me up and hurl me into the sea. Then the sea will quiet down for you. Listen to this next part. I've got it highlighted in my Bible, and it might be something that might be meaningful for you to do as well. For I know that it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you. That it is because of me, Jonah, that this great tempest has come upon you. Let this be a lesson to you. When you run from God, when you try to get away from what it is that God has called you to do, you're not the only person who suffers. You're not the only person who experiences hardship. Parents in here can amen that, right? They know when their children, when they try to get away from God, you may think that it hurts you as a teenager. But I can only imagine what it's like as a parent to see their child far away from God. And I can only imagine, as someone whose father's not a Christian, I can only tell you what it feels like to see my father not following after Christ. You see, just because you are choosing for yourself to go away from God, just because you're trying to get away from what God has called you to do in your life, doesn't mean that you're only hurting yourself. You can hurt other people. See, Jonah was putting these people on the boat in great danger, and so they don't want to do it. They don't want to throw them overboard, but ultimately they decide that if they don't do what Jonah's telling them to do, what's going to happen? They're going to die, right? They're going to be killed. And so in verse 15, we see that they picked up Jonah and they hurled him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Okay, exactly what he said. We're all running from something. You need to understand that whether you're running from God or whether you're running from what God's called you to do, we all have a place that we try to go. It always seems better, but it always ends up hurting us, and it always ends up putting other people at a disadvantage, and oftentimes it ends up putting other people in great danger. So if there's anything about Jonah that we can kind of identify with, it's that, number one, that we've been called by God to do something, but it's also that God has not only has he called us to do something, that we're moving towards it or we're moving away from it. We're either moving closer to God or we're moving farther away from God, and that is our choice. So what happens? We wouldn't know the story of Jonah. We wouldn't know the account of Jonah if it wasn't for the next portion of the story. Verse 17, and the Lord, I love that he said the way this is written, the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and for 3 nights. I love the fact that God appointed to Jonah this big fish, this great fish. And some people say it's a whale. Some people get upset if you call it a whale. It was a really big fish. It was a bigger fish than any of us have probably ever seen in person. I mean, it's unimaginably big for Jonah to be able to have lived and existed inside of this animal, inside of this fish. And so it seems like at this point in the story that, what? You know, I ask myself oftentimes, what do you think Jonah was thinking when he told the people, when he told these people on the boat? What do you think Jonah was thinking to himself when he said, the way that this storm is going to stop is if you throw me overboard? What do you think he was thinking? It was suicide, right? Jonah had hit that rock bottom in his life, and he realized that he had disappointed God, and he hadn't just hurt himself, but he was hurting other people, and he said, all of this will stop if I go away. All of this will stop if you get rid of me. And so if you'll throw me into the sea. He wasn't imagining the great fish. He wasn't envisioning this great fish that comes. Because the point that we make here is that Jonah had given up. And Jonah, he said, I'm suicidal at this point. I'm ready. I know that I've hurt myself. I've hurt other people. I've hurt my God. I've hurt the people of Nineveh. If I'm out of the picture, everyone's going to be better off. And so I want to end it. And they throw him overboard. And Jonah needed to be rescued. And just like us, we all need to be rescued at times. Anybody ever need to be rescued? Anybody ever need forgiveness? We got some hands. Anybody ever had a moment in life where you couldn't do it on your own? That was Jonah. Jonah was just like us. He had hit rock bottom. He had hit that point where there was no return, and that he was hurting other people. He was hurting himself, and he gave up. And he told him, throw me overboard. I'm ready. I'm ready for this to be over with. And what happens? God appoints a great fish. See, we all need to be rescued, but we don't always expect it to be a big fish. When I think, you know, God rescues, and in this scenario, you know, I guess they didn't have life preservers at that point, but I think of this big God-sized life preserver that he throws down to save Jonah. That's not what he does. He sends a big fish. And so you look at the big fish and you think, I mean, is there anybody here that thinks that spending 3 nights in a big fish is a good idea? Anybody, does that sound fun to anybody? Sound like a vacation idea? I don't think so. It doesn't even make sense in our mind. We can't hardly imagine it. It had to be terrible, right? And so as we read this part of the story, we think to ourselves, well, that's kind of terrible that God would send this big fish. But you think about this, it's way better than drowning. It's way better than drowning. I'm thankful that God appointed a big fish, because all of us at some point in life are just like Jonah. We're going to hit rock bottom. And we're going to get to a point where we feel like maybe the world's better off without us, and we're going to need to be rescued. And guess what? Sometimes it's not always the rescue that you expect. You know, I don't think that anybody in here wants to get caught cheating on their test in high school. But I tell you, it's a whole lot better than learning at a very young age that cheating is not a way to live when it comes to schoolwork, when it comes to relationships, when it comes to marriage. And this illustration can go on and on and on. Sometimes the things in life that don't seem all that fun, like the big fish, oftentimes are the greatest deliverer of us. And it was in this moment where something to us that seems kind of strange, it seems kind of gross, and seems kind of hard, is exactly what God uses to save Jonah. Now, look at his prayer. Let's start at chapter 2. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the belly of the fish. I underlined that in my Bible. From in the belly of the fish, he says this prayer. I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Isn't it great that we have a God that when we call out will answer us? Out of the belly of Sheol I cry, and you heard my voice, for you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the sea, and the flood surrounded me. All your waves, your billows passed over me. And then I said, I am driven away from your sight. Yet I shall look again unto your holy temple. The waters close over me to take my life. and the deep surrounds me. The weeds were wrapped around my head at the roots of the mountain. I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought me up, yet you brought up my life from the pit. Who brought up his life? O Lord, my God. When my life was fading away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you, into your holy temple. Those who pray regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love, but I, with a voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you that I have vowed I will pay. Salvation belongs to our God. We'll go through life at rock bottom looking for rescue, looking for forgiveness, looking for an opportunity to get out of the predicament that we're in. And the only place that you truly find that is in God. The only place that you find true forgiveness, sufficient forgiveness, the only place that you find true rescue, sufficient rescue, is in our Heavenly Father. And that's the point that Jonah ultimately had to get to. And the Lord spoke to the fish. It was after this moment, after God rescued him, after he spent these 3 days in the fish. Verse 10 in chapter 2, and the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah out onto the dry land. See, Jonah is just like you. Jonah was running. I think we're running too. Jonah was just like us because he got to a point in his life where he needed forgiveness. And he needed rescue. And just like Jonah, I think there are days, and some of us probably can think about days like today or yesterday or as recent as this week, that we need rescue. And I hope that you'll find that rescue not in anything other than God. And God, of course, as we see in this story, is faithful to deliver. So the last thing I want to point out to you that is similar about your life and is similar that you can see in Jonah is this, is that we all need a second chance. Let's keep reading into chapter 3. We're not going to read all of it because we don't have time to finish up everything. Jonah chapter 3, starting in verse 1. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. He didn't get it the first time. He didn't listen the first time that God came to him and said, Jonah, I'm ready for you to go to Nineveh. I want you to call out against these people because their evil has been brought before me. I've got a job for you, Jonah. But after all of what we talked about in the storms of life and betraying his God and putting other people in great danger and being able, kind of hitting rock bottom, saying he wants to give up, being rescued by God, spending time in the fish, here he is after all of this. And God says what? Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. I thank God for second chances. Anybody in here ever, you can raise your hand, anybody in here ever need a second chance? Anybody ever need a second chance? I tell you, I need second chances, and I need third chances, and not because it's something that I take advantage of, but I tell you, I struggle with sin every day, and I'm not going to pretend that I'm better than anybody. I struggle with sin every day, and there are days that I need second chances, and I'm thankful that we have a God that gives second chances. So I have that underlined in my Bible. And the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, and again, it's just what he said before, arise and go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out to it the message that I tell you. So, and here's where it's different. Last time in verse 3, it starts with but. This time in verse 3, chapter 1 in verse 3 says but Jonah did something different. But in chapter 3 in verse 3, it says, so Jonah, what? He arose and he went to Nineveh. And if you keep reading down to verse 5, it says, and the people of Nineveh believed God. Isn't that incredible? Isn't that incredible that somebody who at one point in time he didn't want to do what it was that God had called him to do, and that he got a second chance to do that, and that because of what Jonah did, the people believed God? Does that scare you? That scares me a little bit, that God is counting on me to do what I'm supposed to do so that people can believe him. Think about that. Does that scare you? That scares me a little bit, that it's on my account that some people are going to believe God because of the way that I act and the way that I speak and the things that I say and the way that I act and the credibility that it gives the things that I say. I told you that I love sports. I'm a big sports fan. I got a video clip I want to play anybody college football fan? Of course you are, everybody. So I've got a clip I want to play about an old football game back before they had face masks. And you're probably surprised that they had video cameras. But anyway, and if you've ever watched the Rose Bowl, then you may have seen this clip before.
Celebration of the football and ran 65 yards the long way before his teammate wrestled into the ground at the one. A block punt led to a safety, an 8-7 Georgia Tech win, and a dubious place in history for Roy Reed. The 100th Rose Bowl game on ESPN.
That's an advertisement that's, what, almost, what, 3 years old, 4 years old. Roy Regal, we've seen it. We just saw it on TV. Playing center, Rose Bowl, and at that point in time, the Rose Bowl was the biggest bowl game that you go to. 1929, right? Right? 1929. He has the opportunity to pick up this fumble, and he runs the wrong direction. That's embarrassing, y'all. That's embarrassing. I never played football before, as you can tell, but that would be something that would be of great. I mean, that would be absolutely embarrassing. And what's worse is he didn't even get it into the end zone. Like, it's not only is it bad that he was running to the wrong end zone, he didn't even make it to the other end zone. His friend stops him, right? And as you hear, they end up trying to punt. They block the punt. They end up losing by a point. Punt's worth 2 points. So this is what ends up causing them to lose the game. Well, this is right around halftime. And so they go into halftime, and Roy is absolutely devastated, as you can imagine. From what I've read, that he went to his locker, he took off his shoulder pads, and he put a towel over his head, and he put his head between his legs, and he sobbed like a baby. He cried and he cried and he cried. And again, I've never been in a football locker room, but I'm going to assume to a team that's when the coach comes in and says, "Hey, you did this good. Hey, we need to work on this. Maybe next time we won't run towards the other teams." Anyway, the coach was speechless. He didn't say anything for the entire time. He didn't say a single word. Everybody just stared at one another. It was embarrassing, right? And the coach, everyone's waiting for the coach to say something, and the question in their mind is Roy Regal going to go out and be able to play in the second half of the Rose Bowl? Are you going to take him? Are you going to pull him out of the game and not let him? Are you not going to let him play anymore? Are you going to, I mean, what are you going to do, coach? And he says nothing until the timekeeper steps into the locker room and he says, "All right, coach, you got 2 minutes. You got 2 minutes till you got to be out on the field." And again, he's silent. He tells everybody to go out. He calls everybody out onto the field. He says, "We're going to play just like we played the first half. We're not going to make any changes." And everybody jumps up, and they charge the field like they did the first time, except for Roy Regal. Roy Regal is still sitting by his locker with his head between his legs, sobbing like a baby. And so his coach walks up to him, and he says, "Didn't you hear me, Roy? Same as the first half, you're going to play. Same as the first half, you're going to go back out there. I don't care about the mistake you made. It's time to get out there and play." And what Roy said was, "I can't do it. I've embarrassed myself. I've ruined my family's name. I've ruined the University of California. I've ruined your name. I'll never be able to play football again. I'm so embarrassed. I'm a failure, and everybody's going to make fun of me." And what his coach said to him was this. He said, "Roy Regal, you get back out there because there's still a half to play. That game is only half over with." You see, that was the message that God was giving to Jonah when he spit him up on that shore. He says, "Jonah, get back out there. The first half may be over with, but there's still a second half to play. And you still have a job to do. And you've still been called to go to the city of Nineveh and cry out against their great evil." Now, I wish that illustration turned out a little bit better and that Cal ended up winning, especially because I'm a Georgia fan and I don't really like Georgia Tech. But in Jonah's case, it works out really well that the people of Nineveh, they believe who God is. They believe God's instructions, because he took an opportunity at a second chance. And so I want to encourage you tonight. I know you're on the run. You're either running towards God or you're running away from God. Maintenance is a myth. You're not staying in one place. You're either getting closer or you're getting further away. You're either running away from God, you're either running away from what God's called you to do, or you're trying to get closer to him. And I hope that with all of your being, you're trying to get closer to God. All of us are going to find points in time where we fall short that we're going to need to be rescued. And I'm thankful that we have a God who is a great forgiver. I'm thankful that we have a God that loves to give second chances to his people, because he loves us so very, very much. And tonight, as we start to wind things down, I want to encourage you as you're thinking about your relationship with God. Let me share one last thing. That we have another minister at Peachtree City named Chris, and he's been kind of preaching a lot recently. So he's not a preacher. He's not been preaching for a very long time. And so we go to lunch very regular, and he kind of bounces off his ideas that he's going to speak on. And so this past week, it was my turn to kind of flip the script on him and say, all right, Chris, I've got this idea. I'm talking about Jonah. What do you think? These are some thoughts that I have about what that story means. And we were in the car in my truck, or we were in the parking lot in my truck. And he looked at me and he said, when I think of the story of Jonah, I love the fact that when it comes to Nineveh, God could have chosen anyone. You think about that? Nineveh, like it is a definite fact that Nineveh needed to be delivered. And God could have chosen anyone in the world to deliver the people of Nineveh. God could have chosen anybody in the world to change the people of Nineveh's hearts. But he chose Jonah. And not only did he choose Jonah the first time, he chose Jonah the second time. And so it becomes kind of clear when you ask yourself that question, when you think about why God chose Jonah, is that this is not the story of God delivering Nineveh. This is the story of God using Jonah to deliver Nineveh. And so the question I want to leave you with this evening is this. Who is it that God is trying to use you to deliver? Maybe it's yourself. Maybe you are the one who is keeping yourself from deliverance. Maybe you are the one who is keeping yourself from believing the truth of God. But whatever it is, I want to encourage you to make a transition. I hope that you'll stop heading to Tarshish this evening and that you'll try to head back to God. Here's what I know. You have a God in heaven who loves you and has invited you to call him Heavenly Father. The New Testament is incredibly clear into how we do that. It's through a believer's baptism. And so this evening, I want to encourage you, if you've not done that, don't run. Don't run away. I want to encourage you to run to God. This may be your second chance. This may be your third chance. And here's the thing about second chances. You don't know how many that you have left. So I want to encourage you to take advantage of this opportunity tonight. I'm so thankful for the opportunity to hear the church at Highland gave me to share Malvin. And I want to encourage you that if there's anything that you need, I know that this good church would love to pray with you. Your youth ministers here, somebody want to share with you in this and what you're going through. So if there's anything that you need, I invite you to come now as we stand and sing.
One thing we ask of you, one thing that we desire, that as we worship you, Lord, come and change our lives.